those spaces that end up not feeling aerated. Some of them do not pay attention to the critical aspects of aeration, which technically is called cross ventilation.
What is cross ventilation?
Cross ventilation is, in its basic description, is that I must have an opening through which air comes and another through which it goes. If this is my room,
yes.
If I have a window here and I have a window here,
yes.
I have addressed the issue of cross ventilation, that wind can blow through my house, because it's the movement of air that creates the ambience that we enjoy.
It does not matter if I have a window in front and another one behind. That doesn't matter.
Yeah,
as long as I have something that
that
allows air to come in
and go out through another way. The window could be here and here. Different aspects of cross ventilation come into play. But the critical thing is that air must move.
True.
If it doesn't move, that's how you end up feeling like
suffocated.
You're in a poor quality space. Yeah. So that's why you raise the issue that some people will have a house on a large open area, but still not feel like their house is aerated enough. It's because of things like that. And then, of course, there are issues that come with clients or developers picking ideas from environments that are different from ours.
By saying that, you mean, this is Africa, or this is Uganda.
Exactly.
And one has traveled maybe to Europe.
Exactly.
And they think that exactly can fit.
Exactly. Here. Yeah, that happens a lot.
Is that bad?
It's not bad. It's not bad, because in creation or creativity, there are probably no original ideas. We all improve an idea.
Exactly.
That we have seen, improve it and make it better or function better or run better. Yes. And following on that, I think if a client sees something from, let's say, Canada, where temperatures drop up to negative 18 degrees.
Yeah.
If you want an idea like that to work for you, ask your architect to review it. Tell him, you know what? I've seen this style of window. How do we incorporate it in my house and and our environment? Then the architect will have a good analysis of how we can pick aspects. We might not import it in its whole format, but we can pick aspects of it that will make you feel like you have it and it's doing well for us in our environment. Yes, that is a critical thing. But like I mentioned earlier also, is that there's a problem of clients not trusting that the architect is actually giving them their best.
That trust, how do you want the client to trust you? How do you feel that now this client has trusted me fully?
If the client really trusts that you're going to give them what you want, or if they trust that you're going to do it this end to end, because the misconception that architecture is about walls has eaten up people's minds. Because once I prepare the plans and I give you a copy, you immediately want to go and dig the foundation. But you must give me time to design your windows, to design your doors. What type of handle are you going to use? Okay? What profile are you going to use to make your windows? What is the paint? What will the floor tile look like? What is the thickness of that floor tile? How are we going to... The architect is supposed to design it all.
So
that is the musician we talked about.
No, that is the very stage when all the above is supposed to be discussed.
Yeah.
The tiling, the painting.
Everything. Everything has to be discussed with your architect. There is no two way about it.
Absolutely.
If you want to go to the market and buy tiles, the first person you call, Mr. Architect, I have reached the stage of buying tiles. Mr. Architect, I've reached the stage of buying a ceiling. Mr. Architect, I'm going to buy bathroom fittings. Mr. Architect, I'm going to do this.
Now, Mr. Architect, there's a problem. Why maybe people have not been looking for you? Because they always assume that your prices are way above their budget. You know, like how you can be there and like your willingness to use an architect is on 100%. But then you find that the ability is compromised.
You afford, you think you can't afford the architect.
And they choose to opt another one. Like
for an alternative.
An alternative. Now, what are the costs?
Okay.
Because it is affecting.
Yeah, I know. First of all, tell our viewers that there is a big misconception out there that architects are expensive. A very, very big misconception that architects are expensive. Because the architect is not just designing the house. He is designing your way of life. Okay? And giving it his professional time to create something that you're going to have for probably the next 50 years. Okay? So, there is a scale of fees. A scale of fees that is held in the Constitution. What percentage or what rate should the architect charge? But even with that, we have cases where clients negotiate those figures.
Do you mind sharing what the law or the Constitution stipulates, like that standard?
I don't have all the figures of CAF, but they are really, really, really. Because I'll give an example. If, for example, you go to build a house of say 100 million.
But also it's relative. A house of 100 million is relative.
Yeah, it's relative. Just I'm just giving an example. Cost of 100 million for the house.
Some of the clients don't know the right thing to be done. Perhaps they think after paying this fee to the architect for the drawings, it is done. Maybe they don't know that you're supposed to be with them on every stage. And others may even think that on every stage, the professional come, you're going to meet certain
costs.
And that's why they choose, like, okay, I have a plan, I have the drawings, I have the plan, it's approved. So now let me get someone else. Do your clients know the services they should get from you?
There's a yes. Some clients know, and they know that sometimes there's a cost for me to leave my office and come to your site in Mbale to look at what your contractor is doing, and they opt to skip that price. But at what cost? You're building a 2 billion building and you cannot afford to give the architect a fuel facilitation of 400 or 500,000 to come to site to have a walk around and say, I think there's a problem here, and probably that problem could have caused your 2 billion building to collapse. Are we together?
Yes.
So it's a trade-off. How do you want? You live with your mistakes and one day your 6 billion investment goes down, or you pay the architect 400,000, 500,000 and he comes to set to have a look. Okay. Then other clients genuinely do not think the architect should be involved. And you can't blame them. There is still a lot of work for the architect society, the Uganda Society of Architects and the Architects Registration Board to teach and to sensitize what the architect actually does for you as a developer, for you as an investor, for you as a city council, for you as a town council, because our role doesn't end just with you as Hilda. No. Just imagine if you're an investor with $10 million, what kind of investment can you put up in a town council like Jida? And what multiplier effect will that investment have on the economy of Jida and the surrounding areas, and ultimately the whole country? Okay, you're probably going to build a building that will attract the headquarters of Amazon in Africa. But what kind of building does Amazon actually take? So the architect is your ally in all this. Because if I'm a city council, I'd make sure that everyone has buildings done by an architect. Why? Because if my city, Fort Poto, has beautiful buildings, one day I'm going to attract the headquarters of MTN to move from Kampala to Fort Poto.
You see, Mr. Nyanzi,
yes.
What we try actually to move away from is like that. Because like, if we are discussing, and we are discussing a multi-billion
project.
My people will be like, okay, I have 50 million to get my three-bedroom house. So I don't need an architect. So can we calm down, meet a Hilda who has saved his 50 million for 10 years and he wants to get proper living?
If I put the context right,
yes. The
guy who has $10 million to invest in Kida is probably picking it from a box of $1 billion. If he lost 10 million, he'll not lose sleep. But Hilda, who has been saving 5 million shillings for the last 10 years, if she built a house and it collapsed, do you know how she'd feel?
Devastated.
10 years of savings, it has all gone. But why? Because she didn't want to pick from the 5 million. Pick a simple 400,000 to give Nyanzi, to give her a proper design. So that her 5 million she has been saving for the last 10 years is safe. So the risk is bigger on you, the smallholder, than to the multi-billion investor. Because you have worked triple hard to save your 50 million. Or sometimes you go to a quack, they design the house, and it's in the neighbor's plot. You get, you build, your master bedroom is in your neighbor's plot. Your neighbor comes one day and says, what is this? Will you afford to compensate him out of your small 50 million you've been saving? You probably want, so it's a lot of things. You have only 50 million. You want a professional to design you a house within your money that you will build and finish and occupy so that you can stop paying rent. So this guy has done something that is so big. By the time you finish putting the ring beam, all your money is gone. So where, tell me, what would you rather have? You'd rather have the architect. Because if he does not, you can get redress. Depending on your terms of, if you can get redress, depending on your terms of engagement. And then some buildings, for the purpose they built. For example, if I built a store.
Yes.
For example, these two rooms were built as stores initially. Although now, there are people living in them. So if I'm building a store and for certain it is a storeroom, sometimes you might not need to put ventilators. Also, depending on what you're going to store there, the ventilator might not be above the window. It might not be above the door. Eh? It might be in the door itself.
Like?
Yeah, there are some doors that they make and they put a strip of louvers in the middle of the door. In the middle of the door. So that you have an exchange of air. So there are so many alternatives, and depending on the purpose of the building.
No, like the arcades, what happens?
Because
there are no ACs?
There are no ACs, yes. And there's no cross ventilation.
Some of them. You know, like how you can even move, and then the back of them, zero.
And the back,
this is a building,
and that's
and
a building.
Next one's a building. They have only...
you've been there. I know how the environment feels.
You've been there.
Yes.
So, what is that? Is that how they're supposed to be?
Okay, ideally, a closed environment like that is supposed to have a good flow of fresh air. And I think some of the buildings have tried by having a core in the middle of open voids so that hot air and raise and go out. Eh? You've seen those open spaces where you stand on the 10th floor and you can see,
and you see
all the way. Yeah, those are intended to create a stack effect.
Thank you so much, Mr. Abdul Wahab. It was a pleasure having you on our show. And the information we've gotten, it is amazing. Words cannot explain to our viewers. Today we have been having an architect who has advised us on the proper aeration of our homes. It is very important. Avoid losing money. Avoid losing time. Avoid attracting certain diseases that you may not know just because you did not know the right thing to do, especially on the aeration of your buildings. Don't forget that every Saturday, in the Saturday Vision, we have a pullout, which is homes and construction. You will find lots of topics that are going to be detailed. You're going to read, you're going to learn, and you'll change a place, you'll change this Uganda, you'll change this nation. Me and you are going to have a better place to live in. This is the Homes and Construction Show. My name is Hilda Kamkama. Don't forget, every Sunday from 7:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m., we will always be on your screens to bring you all the topics that you are looking out for. Until next time, bye-bye.